Main Street Partnership, it's a lot of information here, but one thing I wanted to, want you to see was the, just the Rocky Mountain history, our participation with the, with Main Street, and it's laid out there. And I also wanted to emphasize that we, that there are two rating affiliate for credit. And just mark the status, annually we are evaluated to determine if we're an affiliate or credit status. And then all of the members have to agree to meet basic standards of performance. And I just wanted to point out that to be an affiliate, you have to meet these North Carolina Main Street standards of performance, and you see them all laid out here. And one of the drivers between being an affiliate or accredited, one of the drivers is our comprehensive Main Street work plan and how we perform against that plan. That is one of the drivers in determining whether we are affiliate or accredited. But beyond that, everything that you have to do, all of the, meet all of these Main Street standards of performance to be an affiliate or accredited. And also bring out that work plan. Just before COVID, it's at the end of the year, we had two planning work sessions with the state director. And out of that work session, there were three priorities. One was a downtown residential focus. And the second was realizing an art district along College Street, where the Baylor Art Center is. And then the third was to finalize the downtown master plan. And that's where we left off with Main Street. Next slide.
Excuse me. So those are the major items that are holding us up from accreditation.
And our major items holding us up is just the item, and that is our Main Street work plan, having that work plan and then performing well against that work plan, that when they go through all of the, they check off all of the boxes of the things that we need to do, that is one that, that's the one that's held us up from being labeled with credit.
What is your work
plan? CCRP, Central City Revitalization Plan, panel. They determine the work plan, they determine where we want to prioritize our efforts.
But does that have to be submitted to the City Council for review? Is submitted to the Main Street Partnership, Main Street Partnership?
Well, I think we submit it. If there's something in it that requires council approval, then it would be submitted. But when they determine where they want to prioritize, that we have historically.
It seems to me, I would prefer, that's just me personally, that no committee commits the city to something that we haven't signed off on. And it would be great if we could receive, and maybe we've done it already and just didn't know we did it, didn't read all the material or something. Before there is anything submitted to third-party entity for accreditation for the entire city, I would assume that it would be good if all of us would be able to at least review it, sanction it, and then send it back to CCRP for submission. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I was going to ask the city manager in reference to, but you just cleared it up. When I read the articles in the newspaper, it seems as if council, we're not doing what we're supposed to do, have the credit. And from your explanation, or your explaining to us today, I would say if you're accredited, it's an A+, and if you're affiliated, it's an A. So it's not that much difference in between accredited and affiliated, but we get slammed a lot for not having this information accredited for Main Street. And I agree with Councilman Blackwell. CCRP or any other committee or commission, the one I bless it would be good. good for us to review it and send it back if they want to tweak it or add to it. One way how we can keep up with what's going on as far as the credit and July. But it seems to me that really not a big difference between being a credit and affiliate, plus all the work that you're currently doing downtown, where we're closer to downtown. I think it would be more than a plus once these things, these projects come to fruition.
Yeah, it was more technical.
Just for clarification, guys, some of work plan is the same thing as master plan. Those kind of interchangeably.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, do you mind just backing a little bit?
Okay.
Kind of walk through the difference. Okay, it'll be helpful.
Yeah, it's an annual work plan that the CCRP lays out, where we will lay out the amount of work that we want to get done in the coming year. And it's not, it could come out of a master plan, but it's not, yeah, it doesn't require a master plan.
Just remember what we asked you. It seemed as if when the paper was talking about the city not being accredited, it never mentioned the CCRP not completing the work plan, but always that it's always back on the city manager and council. And so it seemed as if there are some advocacy that was printed in the paper and attached to shadow of the work that we're trying to do within our downtown. So I would like the city manager, along with the downtown manager, to review the work plan. Yeah, why I sent it to us so we can see if it's the vision that we have currently for our downtown. That way we can sanction it and bless it. And then make sure that the work plan is followed through so we can be.
Yes, let me thank you for the work you're doing there. It's our grant and other opportunities that from the business owners has been great. But can you talk a little bit about, are you guys at virtual meetings there? Is there anything going on with this group collaborating with downtown merchants as well as those on board?
Well, we don't have, in regard to CCRP, we don't have virtual meetings. But in terms of collaborating with businesses, I remain engaged working with businesses that we've supported programs like that. And I was going to cover Downtown Cares, that program where the restaurants came together and provided meals to the elderly. And we got support from the city and other organizations to provide those meals and some other businesses. Restaurants, and they're also having events, activities downtown.
Yes, and the Prime Summer House with Boys and Girls Club, and as well as purchasing produce from community gardens and farms in the region, which is a great collaboration. Thank you for having all that. It really have built the morale of downtown.
Yeah, they're fighting, and they're doing well. Well, basically speaking, it's going.
You know, good stuff. I think it would be prudent if we shared the assessment from the receiver back from the people on Main Street. And we give some insight on why we're affiliated, not accredited. And it might even be helpful if those parents from Commerce, maybe we can get a presentation from her, because I think we can shed some light to this council why we're not accredited. Because I don't totally understand everything, but you know, we're looking at this report, and I'm happy to share it with everybody. Inside the property.
Well, so that's the annual information that we put together and sent to Main Street, and then they evaluate.
I don't know, they evaluate place to sit.
Yes.
And the other thing is, if we ever fall out of the Main Street, we can't get back in, because it's only for towns that are less than 50,000 population. If we ever fall out, because we're grandfathered in. So if we ever get out of the Main Street, we can't get in. And it's my understanding with affiliate, one thing that we are lacking is some access to some grants, such as in the COVID, it's my understanding there will be some grants available for main towns that we don't have access to, because we're just...
And I heard that, and we talked about that often, what grants are available to create this affiliate. And there may be something on the national level, but we have, there's nothing significant that was available to credit downtown chambers. And it's like, we have to, and meet those standards that are laid out, we have to meet those standards to remain affiliate. So because we're not accredited, I mean, there's no risk of us getting kicked out of the Main Street. The standard is, the main standard is to be affiliate. And then you can see the history of our ratings, how share that with banks.
I have a question.
Behind the camera,
if we have outgrown...
His laptop going on.
Now, their names are pretty disgusting, but I'm going to try
to... I'm not aware of a program like Main Street or a self-created Main Street.
Which is kind of like, what? I don't just say that, I said one of the players.
I have just made a few comments and observations. First of all, it appears to me that discretion between affiliate accreditation is very subjective. Standards of performance will be the same. And I think the quote that has come from Ms. Perham is the difference is bragging rights. But there's nothing really substantive, such as access to grants or anything else, that would push us to become accredited. Secondly, the work the CCRP is really what drives this, or is supposed to drive this. That's why the CCRP was established. One of those reasons, when Main Street was a very popular program much earlier than it is today. And through the committees of the CCRP is where the work plan is actually developed. And Kevin supports the CCRP in that effort. So I'm not aware of anything that would replace it, but quite honestly, I'm not so sure what we really gain from it, other than a badge of honor, or say we are accredited, and if there's no difference between accreditation and affiliation, I think the work of the downtown will continue with or without Main Street. However, since we've been associated in a part of it, certainly could be an affiliate. We pay our assessment, I think, every year to the state office, fair minimum amount, $300.
The national agency.
Right. So, but the advantage, of course, is to go to the state conference and hear what other communities are going to participate in that. So, for the expense, it's not really a great deal of expense. Take something away from attending and participating in the state conferences. I think that would be good. But just want you to know that, and I agree with you, the paper seems to have been hung up on accreditation versus affiliation. In fact, there's really no difference at all. So that would be my observation, and perhaps we'll continue with that. We'll be happy to share with the council the current application that was sent up to give you some idea. But you also need to understand that within that work plan, overcome the expectation of city resources to support the development of downtown National Plan. That's one of the items I understood Mr. Harris to share with us as a part of that. So there are some expenses associated with remaining in the Main Street program in order to meet the objectives that CCRP is putting.
This one clarification, they don't require that we get this.
They don't require it, but as I understood it, it's one of your the master plan is one of the activities of the CCRP. That's the CCRP's expectation within that work.
They want us to have an annual work plan. And then we is that an annual work plan, master plan.
The work plan is what the CCRP has developed. Within that work plan is an expectation to complete the downtown management. So that's what I'm referring to. And that is
losing green.
So we'll evaluate that and make sure that's. Well, there's a work plan, but then within the work plan is a master plan to develop. That's one of the objectives, I think.
That's right. Three priorities that came out of our work session. It was downtown residency and our district and a clean master
plan. Can we approve it?
Well, they haven't prepared it just yet. I'm sure that we will share that with the members of council. That is a planning process that's going to involve where people live in and around the downtown to come up with that.
And that's where I feel that a committee is not equipped to speak for all of the city members. I think that it's admirable for them to say we need to do this as part of our work. But the design, the community engagement, and the implementation that we should be initiated by City Council in partnership with CCRP, working through the that's the policy.
And the mayor going to speak, and so the city manager made sure that the CCRP. Expand that to what Councilman Blackwell said just stated.
Yes.
Do we have a master plan, or is there a plan to have a master plan, or is that something that we're expecting to proposal approval on? Not confused. So we have a plan for one city.
Well, I think it's probably a good idea to start that process up again. I'm sure there are many planning documents about the master plan for downtown that dates back as far back as the Douglas Block renovations. But so many other things have happened since that time, as well as there are other projects looking forward to the very near future that will certainly impact downtown. So it's probably a good idea, what you think, Mr. Harris, for us to restart that process of a master plan.
We can't hear you.
Chris, hold on, we can't hear you. Muffled. You're muffled.
Thank you. Councilmember Miller, can you turn your volume up on your device? If not, you can email your comments to all council members. We will take it into consideration. We cannot hear you. Okay, thank you. Councilmember Walker. Councilmember Walker.
You could hear you a little better.
Yes. Thank you. Make sure you can hear us. Mr. Harrison.
Next slide. Activity and entertainment downtown. Just want to highlight some activities from 2019. One, we had a successful first food truck invasion. We entitled Food Truck Invasion. It was a food truck event that we held in cooperation with the event center. And I would have to say it was wildly successful. We had over 3,000 people to attend. And take time to share that. But it was a great activity. Also, want to bring out that the Imperial Center had their activity. I think sometimes that gets lost as downtown activities and a downtown resource. So the downtown live First Fridays and other programs that were carried out in 2019. Also, had a successful Juneteenth, very successful. And now we have enough bars that we can have bar crawl events. And we had two, and we were very proud of the custom to have a major block party just before COVID. And we also had the spring fair food rodeo at Station Square and the annual Christmas shopping spree. So those things, that's some activity that we carried out in downtown. Now, looking forward to the thing that some of this was brought pre-COVID, but we're going to have more programming at the GPS, a little virtual that, things like movie night and dinner theater, and we are working for a signature music festival for Rocky Mountain. I feel like that's something that that would go well in Rocky Mountain. And when we can leverage some of the things that we had in the past, like the Down East Festival, and also some of the other music events, we feel like we bring them all together and take advantage of our multi venue throughout our city. So, and also again for the craft. So that's something that we're going to continue to work towards. Don't know when we'll be able to have it, but we're certainly hoping that day will come. But more post-COVID, we want to increase our sponsorship of downtown events. Our downtown merchants and partners, they've been very creative around COVID. And so we want to provide more sponsorship and support their activities, like downtown cares. And Tracks also had a Unity Jam that was COVID friendly, social distancing friendly. And this weekend, we pulled together a cycling, kayaking, and rock roll event. And something that we had done before, and it was new to us. And so we want to support them in that kind of activity. And we plan to replace the food truck invasion, since we can't have it, but we're jumping more into a drive-in event, and we're targeting that for the parking lot of the event. So we'll be able to drive-in theater. And finally, the marketing and promotion, that's slide 13. Just want to be needed to overhaul the downtown website. And now we can include some of the business feature and we also create awareness around high-tech programming. Working closely with the communications now to create a downtown promotional video that is the first step in this work and activity for downtown. And we are working on a electronic newsletter that has more flexibility than this is more outgoing to versus our website. So, and we're going to work, that newsletter will be distributed throughout the downtown network and their network, and also the business throughout the city. So we started putting that together. And then finally, just wanted to bring attention to a plan girls in downtown. Right now, this plan for 129 Northeast Main Street, it's a girl of the longest month, and it's part of a overall North Carolina Musicians Girl Project, where the artist Scott Durkin, who's been very successful in girls across the state, he's doing musicians. He's going to the hometown of these musicians and paying girls. He just completed John Coltrane in Hampton. I think Girls Across and Shelby, and he also, I think, next in line is Bird Flat, Black Mountain. And so, I think we'll be some of the concept to do.
I have a question. I know COVID-19 has changed all the rules, but
yes.
Can you walk through kind of the approval process? How do you go about preparing for business downtown? And what do you hear as it relates to that? Folks excited about it or challenged or just out of curiosity?
Right now, we're trying to get the building stock available and ready. And just actually, it is more reactive. I would say it's responding to needs that we get when we look at the space. And then other than that, we rely on our economic development teams.
Sure. Okay, I just was curious. It seems simple, but it doesn't make it easy, right?
Right.
Slow like off.
Well, that's true. And that's part of this promotional video. And that video is the first step in broader activity.
Any more questions?
Kelsey?
The promotional video, will we get a chance to be still working?
Yes.
So we get a chance to see that.
Oh, yes, sir.
Today in the business room, I received a daily email from them. At High Point, their city council is looking at the Senate for their downtown. And what caught my attention more is they used opportunities on. And are you working with opportunity zones in downtown? Because when I pulled up a map of opportunity zones from Commerce, it looks like all of both sides of Main Street, except for one slither, is not part of the, unless I look at it incorrectly.
It's right. Not one slither. It's not.
Right.
Majority of it is. Yes.
So, but that caught my attention, plus the investment cost was $65 million investment to create 120 jobs. And I know things are unique to various communities, and it might be a unique building to have there, but if you're not looking at into it, I would encourage it. Who knows, we might land any fish like that at some point. We're doing it successfully on the Council Way Partnership, and maybe we can use the Council Way Partnership.
So we outline the geography that falls within the opportunity zone. We outline that on our downtown website. But we have gone out and aggressively recruiting developers with the benefit of the opportunity zone, partly because we've you stay in the program for 10 years and you get, you get to forgive all of the capital gains, but we've gone past that window for them to be able to stay in 10 years. And just FYI, Tylertown is in an opportunity fund. The people that bought Tylertown, they put it in a fund. And so it doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to get developed. In fact, development may be delayed because they've taken advantage of the tax advantage, but they don't necessarily have to develop until further out the window.
Comment, we land a big fish over a year ago with the hotel. The opportunities of either city manager, Councilman Blackwood, since he's in his ward, would like to speak to that. So therefore, we're hoping that all members will support the hotel project. We had presentations on Opportunity Zone. At one particular time was at the event center, and then the other one, I think BTW, Boutique Theater, I'm not sure. So, Councilman Dodgers, to answer your question, we have land a big shark out there that we're trying to bring in, and hope that you will participate and help us with that. Now, I would like to see the manager should like that.
Yeah, so I was going to basically advise the council of the same thing. So, as we move forward with the application to the LGC, amending that application now, and anticipate being on the LGC, agenda for consideration for the approval of the financing for the construction of the garage. But that, in essence, is the largest economic development project to come to the city. It is scheduled to bring in well over $100 million in direct and indirect costs, not only to the downtown, but also to all the neighborhoods that surround investment, if I said cost. Cost is somewhere closer to $60 million, but the investment that will be spurred by not only the hotel, but the residential, as well as the commercial retail activity as a result of that. And that would happen, quite frankly, within 2 or 3 years of the construction of just the garage and the hotel.
Can you mention the jobs opportunities?
The job opportunities, I think I would post the job opportunities for construction alone well into the 100 job range. But then after the construction is completed and the business is open and residential living takes place, then you could expect that to at least double, if not triple.
Great. One thing before you, I think you're in your presentation, but the last time you had spoken on page 6, the economic impact, financial incentives, will you list existing incentives, downtown building assistance program, accelerated facade improvement, roof replacement, repair, downtown program incentive. We spoke about a goal of having at least 250 people within the next year and a half. We know we have our DFI project that's soon to come online, and in order to get to that 250, I would like to see you work along with the city manager to bring back to the council maybe an incentive for those who have properties, who have business on the lower level, and create housing on the second floor to bring additional people downtown to help support the businesses that are already here in the new hotel project, along with the businesses that will come along with that. So it would be great if you could work along with the staff, Councilman Blackwell, this is his ward, to bring us back a incentive to help incent folk to create housing in their building.
So, certainly. Thank you.
Very first.
Yes, Councilman Dodge.
Question to Madam Manager regarding the parking garage. You said that you were presenting that LGC, we're going to see that tomorrow too.
Yes, I have advised council several times of that process. And so as the financial numbers are being updated and put in the model, first to recreate the model, once that is completed and the application is ready for submission to the LGC staff, it will come to the council for your review.
What timeline are we accelerating that?
We are pushing really hard. We would like to think that the application will be revised towards the end of this month, the first part of next month. It may very well require a special meeting of council so that we don't have to wait until the next council meeting to have that discussion with you. So we're hoping that we can have the application in front of the LGC no later than September. So that would be a lofty goal for us, but we're going to set that goal and hope that we can achieve.
Councilman Jordan.
I just asked the city manager to give us some information on how we can
We'll be talking about that a little bit.
Next item. Thank you, Mr. Harris, for your presentation. Next item is this utility assistant COVID-19 CDBG funding. Natasha Paul.
While she is preparing for the slide presentation, we just learned this afternoon, all things being heard, that they would follow up with localities in terms of the requirements. You know, HUD sometimes will just make the designation of funds to municipalities without being specific about how you can spend those funds. So, just this afternoon, we learned that they are preparing now to send us the requirements for how the funds are to be spent. You certainly can spend them for utilities. However, there's always a however to this. They're going to require the administrator to show that there has been a loss of wages or unemployment or something that has transpired to impact the household in a very negative way. So that is why you're hearing staff coming forward making the request that we administer these funds as opposed to giving them to a third party to administer so that we can actually keep up with the requirements. If for some reason the council decides to award funds to third party, just know that there will be requirements of the third party to do exactly what we have to do in-house. Otherwise, the city is going to be left responsible for repaying those funds should they be administered in.
But couldn't our team do that in-house, especially if we need to bring on a part-time staff to do that just to deal with COVID? You, city manager, council, we're going to be responsible to be sure that the funds are being allocated. responsibility for the staff to make sure that all requirements are met, far out to the third part, and do that, and it falls back on us, and I don't see that done.
What is the date of order, 124? Say, it's the date of March 20, March 30. I'm recording ready for Cedar Rapids, that will be March 2022, as July 6, 24,227, out of approximately 25,000. Utility question, fourth and fifth are voting on the two. Those accounts residential class only, third floor, we received the grant, total $5,000 to be done, and giving assistance of that program grant to assist customers. The community development block on the government is allocating 306 dollars that we're proposing City Council today to assist about 620 citizens with an addition to the $5,000 that we received from the United Way. For the non-CDBG customers, we will be able to assist about 125,000 citizens with the $50,000. And that will be citizens that are utility of Rocky Mountain customers. So what we'll be able to do is, with that funding, we'll document the hardship, make sure that these customers have provided us the necessary information regarding their financials, meaning payroll, pay statement, showing the reduced hours, or either something from an unemployment security commission that they received unemployment due to COVID-19.
I know some of those customers that probably was struggling before and probably was unemployed before, but won't be able to show
those customers will qualify under the $50,000 that we're proposing through the CDBG, through the CDBG non-eligible.
We probably would have to go back, I would say, and take a look at that. The $50,000 for the non-eligible CDBG, the people who don't meet the income requirements, really is what that pool is set up for, and I think that was as a result of the Mayor Pro Tem's request last time we talked about that. But to address Councilmember Joyner's request, we probably will have to go back and take a look at that because what I understand you to ask about are those people who were probably not able to pay their bill prior to COVID and were unemployed or whatever the circumstances were, and whether or not they can be brought into program that assists with the 309. I would think that we're probably going to have to look for funds to assist them because, just because of the HUD,
yes,
HUD guidelines that we learned about.
Correct.
This afternoon.
Under the United Way program, where we receive the $5,000, the assistance term amount, we had a max of $200 that we were able to assist the customer with. No median income, and it was any city of Rocky Mount utility customer. With the CDBG CD funding, we will be able to assist up to $500 one month. Up to $500 on 1 month utility bill. That's the 80% AMI or the level. The general fund, it will be 1 month up to the 500 with no AMI limit. Now, these monies would be considered a first come, first serve basis, where with the general fund, as they come in and come out, then that money's up to 1 month or $500 will be dispensed at that time, dispersed at that time. Business and Collection Services Department, the Director and Customer Assistance Specialist will finalize electronic, phone, and paper intake process. We are working on making sure that we have an application, a quick app, available to customers that can complete this online. This initiates the intake process. From that standpoint, we will then work with the customers through a one-on-one phone call, and if we have to, we will be able to set up a virtual meeting with that customer, their paperwork, and also work with them through our drive-through to make sure that their intake process runs smoothly. Getting this information and making sure that we're complying with all the requirements within the HUD monies and then also the United Way's monies, we're separating those and documenting them separately to make sure that we're reporting them separately and accurately. We'll collaborate with Business and Development Director to build reports and capture required data. Partner with Communications, Marketing, and Public Relations Department to develop public solicitation notices, outline of program assistance, and level requirements, and also establish a date to begin accepting those applications for the CDBG funding. The next slide gives you just a track record of what our UNO program has done in the past to be able to service for provide assistance for our utility customers. The graphs to the right show the WARM program trends for the last 3 years. The WARM program leads from January to May annually.
Question.
Yes, sir.
I know we call it the WARM program, but in North Carolina and other southern states, we have a stream. Hot summer.
Yes.
And a lot of especially seniors may not the same in the winters. And I don't know if we want to change the name more. So that if any of those who fall in that same category, hot summer.
Yes, we do. Yes.
Okay.
And what we're doing now with the extension of the WARM program, we've extended what we call the Utility Assistance Program, the UAP. So with that being said, we will have that ability to extend past the WARM guidelines to assist with the UAP program.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Hall. Appreciate the information. Thank you so much. I go back to the second slide on the financial impact. Just to get a little better understanding of what it is we're working with. So you're saying about 4,200 of our customers out of 25,000 residential customers, which is about 17%, are over about $1 million.
Almost a
little less than that.
Yes.
So for those amounts, for that amount of dollars, is that money that's slow coming in, or is money that you are anticipating not to receive?
This is a combination of both. We have slow payments coming in, but we also anticipate that those that are not able to meet
their payment arrangement that they currently set with us, that we have moved them into this program, that possibly they will be able to receive assistance.
So you are arguing, I don't know what this is about, so are you being for that subset of, what is it, 620 citizens plus 125, so that'd be like 745 out of that 4227. Do you view those as being the most likely to not be able to pay and often slide into a potential situation where we could be able to do that?
It can vary, but based on the numbers, yes. We're trying to make sure that we get a subset of customers where payment activity has been very slow from that time frame, and that it shows an obvious financial hardship on their account. So with that being said, we're wanting to capture that audience and make sure that we're able to provide the necessary assistance. Out of the 4,200 plus accounts, yes, the 735 have been identified as customers that may default because of the financial hardship.
So you're doing proactive case management.
Yes, sir.
Development and combining that with resource support for those individuals.
Yes, sir.
So for the balance, the rest of the 4,200 minus the 7, whatever that number is, is your staff still working with them to actively collect change agreements if they can't make it and keep the flow, even though it might be diminished, it's still flowing?
Yes, sir.
That's my question.
Yes, sir. What we're doing is we're proactively calling customers, advising them of assistance opportunities that may be outside of the programs that the City of Rocky Mountain is offering, and partnering with other agencies to try to get them a comprehensive list of possible amounts and delinquencies that may need assistance. And as we're making those calls, we're reaching out to the customer, advising them of all options and our options for payment arrangements that have extended beyond what our normal payment arrangement process is.
Okay. And from your perspective, are we, or do you know, are we sort of doing what everybody else is doing? Are we sort of middle run, or are we doing cutting edge work?
I think that we're a little bit ahead of some of the other areas with the extra programs that we're offering and extenuation of extended payment arrangements. Right now, some of the conversations that have been had, the payment arrangements are extending up to the 6 months or past the 6 months, and we're able to do that and then provide additional assistance through the program with the funding, and then also partner with other agencies to try to we're trying to secure those funds from other agencies.
Thank you.
Out of those 745 customers, so I don't want anybody to get that twisted. We're not saying that those customers are just not paying.
No.
Out of the 745, how many of those are repeats of those?
I would not be able to provide that information, but if I dig a little bit deeper, I probably could. So I'll make a note.
And how will we handle as the executive order of the government's fire in July?
So what we have after the executive order expires, the executive order also puts into place that we still cannot do any shutoff in the next 6 months. So with that being said, we're still doing extenuating payment arrangements for those customers, making those courtesy calls to those customers and advising them of the amounts, what can you pay, how much can you pay something mail, we'll be more than happy to take that payment from you by phone. Those methods that we've been working with those customers on and setting those payment arrangements have been producing some results for us as far as collectivity is concerned, collection on those accounts is concerned.
I just want to remind the council that it matters we won't hear during the time before COVID that we have had the City of Rocky in a lot of the company cities, which is 32 eastern, about the western part, not as many. we had had to do similar things when we were burdened with the debt that was supposed to be paid off in 2026. We had recalled the utility customer service policy to work with Citizen. And so this is really not new to us to help our customers when it's difficult times to pay. And so I just want to commend you and your team, your city manager, your team for working with customers, because truly people do want to pay. And so I just want to appreciate all the hard work that you're doing to make this our customers have some pride and come to you all asking to help during this difficult time. So I want to thank you. Are there any more questions? Councilman Joyner.
Are we doing anything still around weatherization? I have been residents who are in a change of mind to do different things to make their homes more efficient.
Yes, sir. I'm glad you asked that. We are working with our development services department with our energy share program in addition to the more program classes. We are in the process of creating a virtual class where customers can take that virtual class online. That's part of one of the requirements in order to complete the energy share rebate process. So we are working with development services on making sure that customers can continue to get that benefit without an issue.
So I would love to get that because our community organizations asking a question, and thank you, Dorothy. We did that in our newsletter as well for recognizing it has helped in my work a lot. Thank you for that.
Councilman Dodge.
Mayor Pro Tem, I've got several questions from this all, and I agree. Thank you. I'm very informative. This is not a question, it's more of a comment, I think, to the council. I think we're just seeing the beginning of this because, coverage has just hit. Obviously, unemployment's increased dramatically. I don't think we've seen a fortunate hit on that because I think it's just going to get worse, unfortunately. Right now, unemployment, we have the state, we're breaking a lot of people have this on the federal level, but that's going to end my understanding is that this month, there's questions if it's going to be extended or not. If it's not, I think.
Well, I honestly think that with our citizen base that we have and the progress that they're making coming to make payments, we don't see such a downturn, but it is slow with the payments. But I do feel like we'll get through.
Right. And then I was curious because we were getting, we didn't even get the July 6th report, I guess, but the last one I had was the 6/21. So we've had a pretty tremendous reduction of people that are disconnections have been laid from 5,406 in June 21 to July 6th to down 4,227. Is that correct?
I do not have the numbers in front of me.
Right. So that's the case. That's good news. And I'm glad to hear you're starting to hear because one of my concerns was to making sure that we had documentation for everything, especially with hardships and so forth, because I think we owe it to the utility customers and to, if we do $50,000 from the general fund, we owe it to the taxpayers to prove, for people to prove that they're under a hardship. One thing I want to make sure is that $50,000, we are going to, in the proposal, and I think I heard it, but we are going to make sure that they meet some sort of income hardship. It's not going to be, I call you up and say, hey, I'm obliged, I can't pay the bill, and they put that in. So, it's unfortunate, but I can't.
With the hardship, yes, but there is no income limit for that.
And that kind of leads me into, I think we're going to have to put a income limit in there based on statute, general statute. I reached out to UNC School of Government, as y'all know, I worry about us giving money. The response I had from Tyler Mulligan was the city is authorized to establish community development programs to provide for the welfare needs of persons of low and moderate incomes, and it references all the general statutes. Persons of low income are defined as earning no more than 6% of local area median income, and persons of moderate income must be defined locally based on factors. I think we have to do that, unless I'm reading into what's being presented to us.
Well, I guess I would question community development. This is not a community development program. So,
what I would say, instead of you trying to explain it now, that we have an attorney that the council would give it to the attorney himself, instead of trying to answer that off the top of your head. I'm not saying you don't know the answer, but I want you to say something and then you can get up to it. And what we can do, we have an attorney that's his job, to also confirm with school government if he needs to make sure that we are in compliance, that we are following all those regulations. Thank you, Councilor Dodger.
I
was thanking you for that as well.
And thank you. And what you stated, Mayor Pro Tem, as well as I asked for the attorney into the before that, because we're going to ask the board manager that. So, as applies to the WOM program, and I'm trying to catch up with everything, WOM is that currently administered by Salvation Army? Okay, so are we talking about taking that away from the Salvation Army?
No, the WOM program is different from the utility assistance program. So the WOM program remains the same as it has always been.
And that's where citizens basically say that. Okay, we put in
the city does not provide money. The WOM program is 100% fundraising. So my department does the fundraising. We create events. We do solicitations to try to raise funds. So that money is being held at the city and being dispersed to the Salvation Army. They do the intake process and send the customer back for final approval to the city, and then we disperse those funds to the Salvation Army. They send it back to us.
Ms. Hall, may I interject, Council Brunkage? I just got a quick question on won't break. Do we have a Cash App address? Is that something that's possible since it's is that too already possible? A lot of people, might not respond to traditional emails, but social media appeal, Cash App address to get, pick up $25 here, get there, just a little couple of almost like crowdfunding.
So what we do have is an electronic option that where you pay your utility bill online, there is a section that says WOM, and then right above that says utility payment. So it's a regular button that you can click to donate electronically to WOM on the city of Rockland utility bill. Now, as far as Cash App, PayPal, anything else, that's something I'm going to have to research and get back to.
Can we just check? That's another thing we have to do. But you never know where you can pick up a little support.
Yes, sir.
Are there any more questions?
Yeah. Thank you. What we would like is just a consensus to move forward, and we will provide the additional information.
Sure. Goodbye. Glad to get the information. Thank you, Ms. Walker.
Thank you very much.
Don't count the coronavirus.
council to authorize required to enter to an agreement with Edgecombe County and submit an application to Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners by July 24th, 2020. It's our recommendation that we do complete this application and also that is that we receive council support in this effort.
That's a question.
Yes, that's all.
Okay, thank you. Hey, Ms. Jones, thank you.
Your email reads, we eligible for $300,000. A letter from the area of Mr. Edgecombe states that we eligible for $125,000. Some difference in that.
I have spoken with him prior to, after the letter came out, and he has given an additional amount of $300,000. But then he has not sent an official letter yet to the city, so that's the reason why we feel.
But you brought that back.
Mr. Edgecombe.
One phone call. Go ahead and take the compliment, that's right.
Thank you.
Council, I have a question.
Is that required vote?
Just need consensus to, so that we can prepare the application and be able to submit it by the deadline, or before the deadline, July 2.
Thank you.
I
we owe back, we don't, proposal is to pay back over 3 year period of time, use various projects, and the other jurisdictions, and your attorney agreed with that, so.
They are, we've not finished the, we had to finish all of the applications in there, and our next step is to meet with the point to receive support council, before we, gave the final numbers to both jurisdictions. And we would like to make sure that we have council support as to what steps we need, because we want to really stress the importance of that. It has to be eligible projects, so that means that each project has to meet the program guidelines that were set by HUD.
Yes, I guess I would maybe some of the members of council who were members when I arrived, when and this has been a issue, I think, even prior to me becoming the city manager here. What took place was that because Edgecombe and Nash did not have eligible projects for a period of time, the city went forward and used those funds to complete the Bill Street and I think the College Street projects. And so now it's time for us to restore those funds. And we've come to the conclusion now that what is owed between the two jurisdictions, between Edgecombe and Nash, is a $1.7 million. And so what we have set aside thus far is almost the majority of it, including the home allocations that the city has been setting aside to reconcile the difference. We're currently, would be currently $316,000 short. So if you just assume that we would receive about the same amount of money from home, we'll be able to fully reconcile this in 2 more years. So the city has been setting aside funds each year to reconcile or to repay these funds back to the two jurisdictions. And so where we are now is once we have finalized all of that information, we're ready to go forward with a memorandum of agreement with the jurisdictions as to how much money the city has set aside for them to use over a 3 year period for their eligible home projects. So that's the best way that I can explain what happened. No, what has happened? Right. That's right. And so rather than the city putting funds up from the general fund balance, HUD has allowed us to use the funds that we would normally get to set aside to address the problem.
Question. I thought Nash County.
Yes, they have. And so these are funds to address a problem. So they still have these funds that are associated with the city. But yes, they are.
So they will not be receiving funding from application.
Right, not going forward.
Not going forward. But we're replacing or replenishing what has been expended that we expended within the city funds.
That's correct.
So the funds, so Nash County and Edgecombe County will be eligible to receive those amounts of money for any allowable development within the confines of Edgecombe and Nash County, regardless if it's in Rocky Mountain.
That's correct.
Remember, that helped with Councilman Clark with his task and assisted there. I guess my question is, do we not have funding for the next 3 years, so the next 3 years we need funding towards these, and so technically Rocky Mountain would have
our allocations, whatever's going to be allocated to the city of Rocky Mountain, we're going to forego that to help replenish the amount that's owed.
Okay. Thank you.
question, with the approval of the funds, I mean, did we, is that a motion in the council session? I mean, she made, you had three requests specifically, do we move on that here, or do we, are we voting on that, break the agenda? So, upcoming meetings on the agenda.
We can do that at the next meeting, or?
In July, so.
Next meeting.
We just wanted to bring this to the attention of council, because they talk with both jurisdictions, to make sure that you're aware of.
So before you bring it back to us, you know you have our support and consensus.
Sir.
And then when we go on, all the circuit will be completed.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay.
Future meeting, not tonight.
Right.
Right.
We'll bring back the MOUs for both jurisdictions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Next person up, none other than our city manager, Rochelle D. Smart.
Yes, sir, thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. What I have in front of you is a proposal to declare Juneteenth as a city holiday. This is in recognition of, I think people are aware of the history of Juneteenth, but this day marks a day in 1865 when African Americans living in Texas received notice that their enslavement was abolished by the Emancipation Proclamation. Juneteenth is a day African Americans across the country, including here in Rocky Mount, celebrate their freedom from slavery, which had existed in the United States and its colonies since 1619. I am proposing that the council considers this as an additional holiday. It follows actions that have already been taken by several jurisdictions within the state. Notably, on June 6, Wake County Board of Commissioners adopted legislation establishing Juneteenth as a paid holiday for Wake County government employees. Similarly, the city of Raleigh on June 7, 2020 also took action to establish this as a paid holiday for city employees. In terms of the cost to our organization, really is in two forms. One is a direct cost of $35,000, which pays for overtime for those individuals who are required to work on a holiday, as they do for all other holidays. The indirect cost would be the regular payroll and benefits, and indirect in the sense that those are funds that are already budgeted. So whether or not employees work that day or not, it is a paid day. So in essence, the additional cost to the budget would really be about $35,000. So with that, it would be my recommendation that council adopts the resolution declaring Juneteenth, a paid holiday for City of Rocky Mount employees. I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Yes.
I just want to go on record that there is question and no question. I want to go on record and make a motion to approve the recommendation from the city manager.
Especially since we just had the
about 2 days into the budget cycle. I wish we could put this in the budget. It's kind of added to, the reason I say that is the whole COVID thing. We don't know where we're going. I mean, I just heard today on the way here, Wall Street Journal said that I think some schools have closed in some big cities. And the impact it's going to have is going to be phenomenal. You know, we've got 21% property here in Rocky Mountain. I just think it would be prudent if we offset it in the budget.
Yes. So when you say offset in the budget, because I didn't come forward with a request for a supplemental appropriation to all of the funds for the budget, the offset comes from, in this case, it would come from salary savings. We budget 100% for all salaries, knowing that there will be vacancies within the organization. And so that would be the offset. That's why you don't have an additional appropriation coming to you to cover the cost of the $35,000.
Mayor Robinson. I'm supporting the two, that's not the question. But the question does is on moving from holidays to PTO, that eliminate the overtime, the direct costs associated with it. And I understand the significance to it being a holiday, Juneteenth, but just from even a general perspective, all holidays.
Right. So the way that our organization works, regardless of even the 10 prior or current holidays that we have, employees of the city continue to work. And so by our personnel ordinance, we're required to pay additional for the overtime. And so that is what the $35,000 is. Oh, exactly.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So that $35,000 is really a standard cost.
Yes.
So it's 10 times 35.
Right.
That gives you a standard cost. So now 11 times 35.
And that is across all of them.
That's going to be the kind of flexible, I
think.
Again, very much to your explanation. My interpretation is great. I come up with Mr. Murray on the third shell, see what I have, you know, that's clear, and I'll set them up. And so you don't add the two together. And I got lost when you're trying to explain the.
So the day of the junkie,
dumb it down a little bit, you don't mind.
Well, so in our budget, we budget for all employees, all positions filled 100%. The reality is that there will be vacancies throughout the year, and that savings is what would offset this additional cost for overtime. First of all, which is why I did not bring forward a supplemental appropriation increasing the general fund to cover that cost, because I think you can absorb that cost within the existing allocation for personnel and benefits. Save. Okay. Does that help a little bit? Okay.
Motion made by, we know we're going to have to go to the regular council to make it official. Motion made by Councilman Jones, second by Councilman Blackwell. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. You show hands like.
Yeah.
I didn't see him.
He left.
Nah, he left early. Yeah, I don't know.
But he wasn't here for the major discussion.
He left maybe 20 minutes ago.
So 20 minutes ago from what we thought.
I couldn't see him. No, it was 20 minutes. We
did you see him when he went over and talked to the...
Yeah, he talked to
him. He went and talked to the city manager, then he left. He came back to the door.
Yeah,
he
got...
Yes.
20 minutes.
Yes.
No, 20 minutes ago from now. Like 5, 10,
Because I couldn't see his hands or anything.
Yeah, no, he got his briefcase.
The raising of hands would be. Councilmember Walker.
There's a gentleman in the chair.
Yeah, he does.
I think so.
Yellow.
Those ten.
What was your vote?
Yes.
Your hands up. Thank you. Vote carries. We know that according to our attorney, our city manager will bring this back for the official council meeting. This going through the.
So, thank you, sir. Would this be on the agenda tonight or the next?
You amended. Yes.
Well, we have to talk about that, maybe, if that's what it's called. Because you know, I'm going to start. Do you mind just go ahead and make the picture box the same?
Probably.
I just want to have a budget, we can take it from our head to there. And that way I know. Maybe not be as thick as.
Sir, could you answer?
Sure.
At this time, we have the Will Grant.
Yes, thank you. It's Brad. I will introduce this. This is a process that I think would be instructive for members of council. You might recall several times in the past, there seemed to have been a bit of a conflict in terms of where the city played a role in these rural grants that came to various entities within the community. I and Assistant City Manager Hampton have had some very important conversations with these gentlemen to make sure that we are all clear about the process and when the city is to be engaged in this process. I think in the past we have been engaged very early, and so it was confusing because I think maybe some of the recipients as well as others thought that the city was unnecessarily delaying the grant process to continue. So we have come to an agreement and understanding as to when they are to bring their applications, completed applications forward to City Council for your approval, which is going to be later in the process instead of in the beginning of the process, because what was happening was incomplete applications were coming to you. And so once you approved it, I think there was an expectation that grant was moving forward through their process when in actuality it wasn't. So my requirement now is that they bring to us a complete application and then we're ready to bring it to you for your approval, and then they can go forward with awarding the grant. So Brad, they're here to explain that process.
Sure. I'm Brad Hoffer with the Carolinas Gaming Partnership. Just appreciate City Manager's opportunity and that introduction of the presentation tonight. We will make this very quick. With the Carolinas Gaming Partnership, we are your primary industrial recruiter, and we depend on state incentives to close deals. And three of the primary state incentives, one is C grants, job development and investment grants, and the third and final one is the building reuse grants through the Rural Infrastructure Authority. So we often use this tool to help close deals. It's very flexible, and we have had a track record of this with the City of Rocky Mount, and we depend on a unit of local government. government to receive the funds, which are then dispersed to the business that is making the investment and creating the jobs. There is often a 5% local match, and that is paid for through the Carolinas Gaming Partnership. And we often will hire a grant manager, which is David Hardigan here with David, with Hardigan Management, who oversees all of the paperwork and administering the grant on behalf of Carolinas Gaming Partnership. So he would be better suited to kind of give you the overview of the program. I invited him tonight to make a presentation, just a quick overview, and happy to answer any questions you have. Steve.
Thank you. Good evening. You've got before you what was passed out are the full program guidelines and application. Right now, I'm referring to the first page. This is how a project starts. It will usually come to you from Brad's office. And at that point, we have to call in the North Carolina Economic Development Partnership in North Carolina. They lead the business and the local government through some preliminary paperwork. When that is complete, the EDPNC then refers the project to the Department of Commerce. Now at that point, this isn't on that sheet, but at the Department of Commerce, there's a funding group of higher-ups, shall we say, at Commerce, who decides how much money and from what program the money will come from. In your case, it won't come from CDBG because you are an entitlement city and you get your funds directly from CDBG, so you're not eligible for the small city CDBG program run by the state. So yours will always be the rural money. After that is decided, that committee comes out with a recommendation and reports all the proposals. It's got a blue cover, you may have seen them. At that point, we can call Commerce. I can call Commerce on your behalf and schedule a pre-construction conference call where the building owner, the local government, business, everyone involved gets on the phone. They used to do it in person, but they don't anymore. And they will then go through the steps that are necessary to put in an application. Now, full application is the next step. That's where the local resolution and the local authorization to submit an application comes in. That's where you will actually sign the application. The mayor will sign the application. After that is done, it goes to the Rural Infrastructure Authority for funding. Now, if anybody has any questions or wants to interrupt me, please do so. And I'm not going to go through this entire thing. Obviously, I'm sorry, let me back up 1 second. This application is a dual application. There's rural building reuse and there's rural infrastructure, which you are eligible for both. If you have infrastructure needs, you can also do that. There's match requirements, 5% minimum. The money for building reuse is a grant to the city. The city then loans the money to the business. The loan is secured to the satisfaction of the city attorney through a promissory note, a lien, whatever satisfies the attorney. So the city is not liable for anything. They're covered, in other words, if something goes wrong. After the application goes in, it is reviewed for approximately 2 months before it goes to the Rural Infrastructure Authority. At that point, any clarifications that need to be made are made. And we find out then whether this is serious. They may say once they figure out they got to give financials, someone will say, I'm not going to do it. They may back out. That can happen as before. Now, right now, you have what I will call three active projects. Unfortunately, none of them are active. And two of them is due to COVID-19. They're just on hold. And the other one is a was a death in the family, and unfortunately the building that we're going to use as collateral is in an estate, so they came before with doing a loan agreement. But you have three active projects, and you maybe brought one this month, next month, to act upon, and we will do that in the proper order this time, I promise you. The reason these things get out of order is usually the business. The Rural Infrastructure Authority, which Mr. Dodridge is on, and he knows they meet every 2 months. And sometimes the business will say, I can't wait 2 months. So we would take an application, put it in, and use it as a placeholder until the business got us what we needed to submit an application. Because if we miss that deadline, it's 2 more months, and sometimes the business just can't wait. So are there any questions?
Yes.
There would be.
Yes. I thank you for coming, and thank you for inviting us. Is there a threshold for a dollar amount of project to participate in this?
It used to be very clear how much you can get per job and the maximum you can get. Nowadays, we're encouraged to use the term up to. And the Rural Infrastructure Authority, the rural program is $500,000 maximum.
Per project.
Per project. Yes. One of your current projects is 500, one is 3, one is 2.
Okay. And so there is no more one $35,000 per job anymore. There's no allocation.
Not even close.
Okay.
It's somewhere between $5,000 and
$12,500. Okay, per job.
Per job.
So you get,
depending on the specifics of the business.
So that's what makes this an eligible project for your involvement, is the job creation component.
Yes.
These are new full-time positions.
Yes.
At market rate with benefits as well.
Yes, sir. There's a certain criteria. The criteria is you've got to be in a tier one or two county, which you were in both. Meet or exceed the county average annual wage. They got to be an identified target industry. There's a list here on the first page of what they are, mainly manufacturing. They have to offer benefits. They have to offer at least 50% employer-paid health insurance. And they will create a significant number of new jobs. I think the minimum is 5. That would be a very small project.
Sure.
Thank you. Anyone else?
So if we have questions or people interested that are listening or watching us so that we might know, do they contact the city or contact your office?
They can contact Brad's office. Or they can contact the city if you prefer Brad's
office. We have a close working relationship with the city, so any projects that would flow, we handle those, and then we would engage with the appropriate officers at the EDNC and NC Department of Commerce, and then at the perfect time, we bring in David Hardy to consult with us on the actual grant application.
And so this is a loan that converts to a grant it's just a strict loan, a grant. If the goals are not met.
Yes. David, you want to cover the requirements for reporting?
If the jobs aren't created, there's a loan agreement that is entered into. That's the one that the attorney goes through. And there is a pro rata payback. If they create half the jobs, they pay back half the money. And the way I explain it to the businesses, of course, we want them to create the jobs, and they're all worried about what if I don't. It's a 0% interest loan. And I say, even if you have to pay it back, we're not going to run to the press and say you failed. You're just paying back a loan at 0%, which is still not a bad deal.
So, of course, city manager, if interest goes from the city, will we
You could refer them to my office, but I would suggest that you call Carolina Gateway Partnership right now. We don't get involved until there's a complete application that needs to come to the council. We're aware of it, but we just don't.
Are there any more questions?
And I also, your manager, if there is a company that has to get going, I will call you directly.
Yes.
Talk to you about it.
Councilmember Joy.
So if there is a amount that these companies started with me or size or what something got last year.
Like I said, the minimum job creation is 5 that I know of. It's really not cost effective to get less than that. And the maximum amount you can get in this program is $500,000.
Mayor Protem. As it was mentioned, I was just reappointed to the board.
Congratulations, sir.
3 years. And just also want to give kudos to the Short Stickers, who also serves on this Rural Infrastructure Authority. So our area is pretty lucky to have 2 folks from National County Service on Rural Infrastructure Authority. And just to let everybody know, transparency, I do recuse myself now from everything that comes up in the state of Rocky Mountains because there's a conflict.
Thank you. Are there any more questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
We appreciate all of you.
Thank you.
Our next item is closed session. Mr. Rowe.
Second.
Motion made by?
Yes.
Mr. Daughtry, second by Joy. All in favor? Aye. We are now in closed session. Second. All in favor? Aye.
Sunset Avenue 4 from 5:30 to 7 o'clock p.m. on Wednesday, July 15th. We currently are working with an engineering design consultant to seek improvements for the quarter. Halifax Road, Atlantic Boulevard. The meeting will take place via Zoom. You can find the meeting ID and more information on the calendar page of our website at rockymountainc.gov. We know that this is a tough time for many of our residents with layoffs and furloughs. As a reminder, per the council's direction, as well as a pair of executive orders from our government, there's a moratorium on all utility disconnections until further notice, and late fees will not be assessed during this time. If you are in need of help with your utility bill, please contact the Business Service Center at 252-972-1250. The OIC continues to hold COVID-19 testing sites at the Rocky Mountain Event Center. Those tested will need to bring their photo ID and insurance cards. Insurance is not required for testing. Testing days are Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Registration can be performed prior to arrival by logging on to OICRMHUB.com. Or you can call 252-210-9856 for more information. I would like to begin by congratulating our city council on the recent release of individual newsletters to their constituents. Newsletters, which are delivered monthly via email to members of all several wards, are designed to inform constituents about the latest news, projects, and focus areas specific to their wards. If you did not receive the July edition of your newsletter, you are encouraged to send an email to communications@rockymountainc.gov. Finally, during this time, it's important to remember to fill out and send in your 2020 census form. The census will determine funding for housing programs, schools, hospitals, economic development, and much, much more in our community. You can respond online, by phone, or by mail. For more information or to respond, visit 2020census.gov.
This time I'd like to present a Black Lives Matter resolution to representatives of the Rocky Mountain Black Action Committee. Thank you, show of chambers.
Oh, yeah. That's part they in that microphone. Okay, we'll do it. No problem. At the beginning we could, but I think it's going to be a text.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Item number 7, petitions to be received from the public. So we have two formats possible today. If you cannot make the steps up to chamber, or please speak into the room that we set up for the first floor.
Yes, sir. Because of the two elevators, City Hall that are not working and are being repaired. For those members of the public who do not feel that they can engage three flights of steps, it's my understanding that we do have a station set up downstairs for us to receive public comment. But for those who can come upstairs to council chambers, we certainly welcome you here to train.
So, Nehemiah Smith, if you please see the person in the chambers to the microphone, we're downstairs.
Good evening. I'm addressing the council concerning parking on the Weeks on Front side of Stoke Street, across from the community. Because of the allowed parking on the Weeks on Front side of the street, it has increasingly difficult for opposing traffic to pass. There are a number of small children who live in those units on that side, but they do provide parking in the back of those units. There have been instances where those children have darted behind cars. And so for their safety and the safety of drivers, members of the neighborhood community are requesting that the Weeks Armstrong side of the street be made a no parking zone from the stoplight Bobby Bowe to Hunter Street. Let me know that if you go a little bit past that, that's Nashville School. Also, as a part of the Mount Zion First Baptist Church's 1871 initiative, we'll be celebrating the Assessment Centennial on next year. Mount Zion First Baptist Church, in partnership with Greenfield Produce Company and Greater George Church, will be doing a food giveaway on the 20th, next Monday at 2 p.m. On the Franklin Street side of Mount Zion First Baptist Church. This past Saturday, we gave 400 boxes. This Saturday, I mean that Monday at 2 p.m., we will attempt to give a good giveaway.
Please give us those boundaries again. I apologize for this moment.
Yes, it's the Weeks Armstrong side of Stoke Street from the stoplight at Raleigh Road to Hunter Street, which is the street that comes on the side of Baskerville, the Hunter Street side of Baskerville. So it's from Raleigh Road up to Hunter Street before you cross over from Baskerville. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I'll ask the Superior Court.
COVID-19 impacted residents who live in their neighborhoods.
COVID-19 infections now surging nationwide and reaching over 83,000 confirmed cases in North Carolina this past weekend, and with the expiration of the CARES Act unemployment benefits just weeks away later in this month of July, Rocky Mount residents are facing increased financial difficulties and rental housing instability. According to information received this week from the National Housing Conference, roughly 30 million of the country's 100 million residents, renters, have little or no confidence in their ability to pay their next month's rent due to the COVID-19 pandemic and its effect on family income. Here in North Carolina, Governor Cooper's executive order prohibiting evictions expired on June 21st, 2020. Now thousands, I said thousands, of our neighbors in North Carolina face the possibility of eviction or becoming homeless. Since the moratorium lifted in our state, according to a report received last week from the North Carolina Housing Coalition, there have already been 10,000 eviction filings posted statewide. These mounting filings are creating a dangerous eviction cliff in just the first 4 weeks. Some of the renters threatened with eviction may not get unemployment insurance or may have experienced significant delays in getting unemployment insurance approved in North Carolina. Others may have lost a significant portion of their income. Many families were already financially stressed and struggling before the pandemic in Rocky Mount, so it doesn't take much to push them over the edge. Let me point out that eviction moratoriums do nothing to help landlords pay their own bills. I don't think we as a community want to see hedge funds own all of our apartment buildings or rental units. But if we don't help the tens of thousands of small business people who own rental units, that's where we're likely to wind up. This growing crisis is ignored at the great risk of tragedy. Without large-scale comprehensive emergency rental payment assistance, our community, like many others, may find ourselves in the position of having local police and sheriff's deputies enforcing eviction orders in low-income neighborhoods just weeks after protests against police brutality and racial injustice. Eviction is a very public experience that impacts your entire community. Your belongings are dumped on the street while your children and neighbors watch. Given the high degree of tension we are already experiencing, we at the Community Academy don't think it's a dynamic that we want to test.
Thank you.
Here's what I'd like the City Council to do. There was $150 million included in a $1.6 billion coronavirus relief recovery package approved by the General Assembly. We'd like to have this City Council make sure that city executives apply for either Nash or Edgecombe County, where the funds will be allocated for emergency rental assistance. Let's take timely action in Rocky Mount to avoid a massive increase in homelessness, which will only drive up North Carolina's already climbing COVID-19 infections. Thank you so much for allowing me to make this statement. Good night.
Thank you. I'd remind everybody that 3 minutes is the limit. I'd like to ask Samuel Battle to come to the podium.
Rules are rules. The street on Rosewood and that avenue in Meadowbrook, we need some work done there. We'd like to see the whole street paved because you tear your car when you come down off the road. And police officers and city workers trying to find out why they're not getting hazard pay and the government's getting all this money, sending it to the city, all different occasions, why the police officers citizens not getting hazard pay. And the number two thing that Wilson getting paid more than the city of Rocky Mountain. That Boston Red only got 14 parts. These people got 40 parts to attend to. And Wilson getting paid more money than the city of Rocky Mountain. Got to do something about that. Number three, Union Cemetery. It's one of the oldest, next to one of the oldest national cemeteries where I got some of the famous history in Union Cemetery. Woods, trees are tearing the cemetery. We need to put a bin in there to keep somebody can keep that cemetery clean. It's in World War I. It's in World War I. So we need to keep that cemetery up. We We got a lot of black history there in that cemetery. Y'all spending money like y'all going crazy in each war. Y'all making sure these wars are getting money in each war that it ain't going back in the community. And that we have a problem with that. On Tarvin Hill Street, the trees are tearing up the sidewalks, and the government gave y'all $4.8 million or something to fix the city up. You need to go down to the historic neighborhood, Hill Street and Tarvin Street to fix them sidewalks, because the streets are tearing up, people are falling down on the sidewalks. I'm just trying to figure out, OICOE gave me $8,000 for the roof. I don't know how true that is, but everybody's been talking about it. I said something about the breast machine a couple months ago. When is it going to be up and running? Can you tell me that? Because I'm tired of hearing lies and everything. My people in the street got cancer and everything, dying and everything. Let me know. Let me know after I can get through talking. And when this counselor in World War I, when is it going to pay that light bill? We need that. 47,000, we need that. We got people like this, old people like this getting turned off for $16 and $22, and we got a man ain't paying no light bill. When that's gonna be taken care of? We need to make that happen. And I've been looking at the paper, and this brought to another rally talking about the property over there in the rally. Well, you're talking about landlocking. We have a man in World War I landlocked too on the church. We need that parking space to get rid of the church. Let's move that church out. Let's move cars parked there. That's what we need to do. Everybody quiet now. I'm done with that.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
When have we received $4.8 million in the federal government?
How much for the city manager?
I'm not aware of that.
Okay, Mr. Gary Barnes.
You're looking at the paper, not reading the paper.
Hello, my name is Gary Barnes. I am one of the co-founders of the Unmuted Organization. I'm aware of the monument being taken down. I'm aware of the street.
Say what?
I can't help but feel like I'm satisfied with that. Our deal problem, a part of the problem. We want justice. We want an equal chance at generational wealth. We want to be included in the conversation when it comes to the rules of power. Why is America so comfortable with placing band-aids of this open wound we call systematic oppression? What justice did that monument get removed and bring to my people? What generational wealth was brought to my people through a street and pain? Black Lives Matter. My point is that we're not satisfied with child's play. Give us the main goals. We want to own property. We want to build schools. We want to teach and empower. We want to have that same chance that our counterparts have. I hope my words cut deep. I hope I step on your toes, because we have had a knee on our neck. What's it quite fun? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Barnes. I'd like to ask Ms. Maureen Menjes to the podium.
Old men give a salute when they say goodbye.
And that's basically what he did. I mean, the poor man, obviously, he did not scare anybody. But I guess unreasonable bias goes both ways. Also, I'm worried about our money. I didn't know we had so much money in Rocky Mountain. And who comes up spending it? Is it true that the city council paid a heck of a lot more to take down a Confederate statue monument just because y'all want it? I guess if the council wanted to have it down for July 4th. It's been there 150 some years, whatever. What was the big hurry to pay that extra money? I mean, as far as I know, the city is having less money coming in. People can't, can't pay the utilities. People can't go out and eat from places. I mean, is the money going to dry up? Or are y'all just trying to spend it as fast as you can? I also want to know who came up with the idea of painting Black Lives Matter on a roof that is in front of the event center of an old train loading dock. I mean, that's not going to be cheap. I'd rather give it to the kids who are hungry. Places they have no place to stay. It's mighty damn hot out there, and I guess all y'all have air conditioning in your house. Some of these little kids don't.
Thank you, Ms. Manchester. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
Just housekeeping. She addressed, I guess, the four of us, or three of us, four of us is dark-skinned people. And for your information, we are African-American.
Or black.
Or black. If you want to address us, that was very racist, stereotype.
As usual.
As usual. We're not darkies. We're not dark. Well, you said dark. Okay. We come in different hues of some lighter than you, perhaps, that are black people. So if you're going to address us correctly. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to also, since you made reference to. Thank you, sir. Since Ms. Benjamin, it's very unusual that I would comment to a public person coming down here and making a comment, but I need to set this record straight with you and anyone else. It appears that you, and maybe some others, think that Mr. Carr's gesture was misinterpreted. It was not misinterpreted because it was directed at me. And either you or anybody else in this public can speak for me in terms of how I received the gesture. So I hope you understand that I don't, and I don't take those kinds of things very lightly, particularly in an environment like this. It was a threat to me. Matter of fact, I think about it quite a bit when I come into City Hall. So, I haven't heard from Mr. Carr. I'll be happy to sit down and talk with him about this gesture. But it was not a gesture of salutation or respect to me. It was quite the opposite. And so it was dealt with. He certainly is allowed to come back into the council, into the chambers, but with restrictions in terms of his gesturing, because the next time it's not going to be as easily handled as it was that time. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Manager. At this time, I'd like to call Mr. Cornelius Dancy to the podium.
Just to say that I continue to support this board.
And I served, thank you for allowing me to serve on the Relation Commission as long as I did. And I'm glad to see the money that come down was money worth spent. It should have been down before the end. I hate that it took the Black Lives Matter movement across the nation to get it done. But I don't understand why certain folks don't understand what's going on in America today. Evidently, they're not paying attention. They're still coming down and talking stupid. I commend you, this board, for standing up and stop allowing people to come in here and disrespect you. You are grown people. I'm loving what I'm here. Continue to put these people in their place. Even if it's me, if I come here out of order, put me in my place. You all grown people, elected by the people. Some people may not like it. That's their problem. If you all elected to do a job, some of you are paid, do your job. Stop allowing folks to disrespect you. Rocky Mountain is being looked at. In spite of what other folks are saying, I travel around the state. People are looking at Rocky Mountain, just setting examples. In spite of all the mess that people come down here and say. So I just want to say I commend you all, not because you're black, my daughter, but because you were elected and you were intelligent. But stop allowing people to disrespect you all. I can't stand that as a young black man, well, 57 man, you don't know. But I can't stand it when I see people disrespect people in authority. They can disagree with you, but not disrespect you. So keep on speaking up, because if not, I'm going to call y'all out. I can't stand on y'all enough to come back and disrespect you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nancy. I'd like to ask Mr. Clint Williams to the podium.
Spending over $700 million and they bowed down and begged for forgiveness is suddenly inept when it comes to little old Rocky Mountain. No, instead of taking the findings and making things right, redressing the $8,000 in improper roof loans for OIC on Gray Street, yes, I've seen the maps, it does exclude it. Just like the China America building, this body continues to break the rules for its own selfish selves, but not for anyone else. Or the improper roof loans on Harbor Street, and the over $47,000 in written off utilities for one supremely arrogant and vile member of this body who still owes over $3,000 to this day. No, this city continues to fail its citizens. You have failed this city because you have been called out. Last week at this Council of State, the auditor called out Rocky Mountain again for its ineptitude. You have embarrassed the city in the eyes of the state for a public body incapable of managing the taxpayers' monies. And you have utter gall, the gall to clap back at her, one of the executives on the LGC who you want to approve the parking deck and hotel downtown. In what fantasy did you think that was a good idea? You made an enemy of the state, literally. You have failed the city. Sign the contract with Rocky Mountain, file a disclosure of your conflicts, redress your failings as a body immediately, repay the funds, and make things right so this community can begin to heal and regain its character and morality. To refuse to disclose your conflicts of interest is a complicit admission of your conflicts of interest and that you are failing the city. Shame on you and everyone complicit with this body. For anyone up here to call themselves a preacher, to be a leader of the Word of God and represent the evils of malfeasance in this community is a damn hypocrite and shall never deserve to have his feet washed.
Okay. Let's call Mr. Johnny Cunningham to the podium.
I wish I'd amen to that, but I can't.
Restaurant on Fish Market. I've been there 17 years.
better man, work hard for his company. And to have him, at first I thought it was racial issue. So I inquired, I was, and I still assured me it was not a racist issue, but a disrespect. Now, when the council and the black population just sit under attack by white supremacy and racism, I came forward and I sounded at home. Because the fight was against racism, because I had that knowledge that was there against this council, just like this Thomas Smallwood. And words and things that was directed to her, that was demeaning, disrespectful. I stood here and called it out that it was wrong. Just like this gentleman, what's happened to him today is wrong. This city, I know, is bold, and the turnaround and the changes that this board has made, this council has made, you're not going to tolerate and send out a message that a modern-day black lynch mob is allowed to target for personal reasons. Like Mr. Smith was a black woman trying to open the fish market, which is the case.
This is not the case.
I said, well then, why after 17 years are you targeting this man in such a vicious, damaging, when you attack a person, social income, their livelihood, what they've dedicated 17 years in building in a black community? He hires me, he's employed two black men. These are men. These men are like me. They are not going to tolerate being disrespectful. So I know that's a lie. As a matter of fact, when I went and talked to the gentleman, he's got video with young African-American girls the same age as the one that filed the first complaint. Of these girls coming into his shop, kicking over his trash can, pushing cash rest over the counter. He's got this bear tilt jump with the head crowd. And it shows them picking it up and throwing it into the kitchen. This, I know, this council is not going to talk about that.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham. I'd like to ask Mr. Cooper Blackwell.
What are you going to do to him?
Do, and nothing negative came up about what it does with this money.
And I find this interesting about this critique, just in a basic Google search, because when I type in what does the NAACP do, guess what was next with its donations? I found this interesting that black organizations and causes, people seem to scrutinize dollars that go to black community organizations much harsher than they do white-owned or even largely established sketchy figures like the Koch brothers. So while the Rocky Mountain Black Action Committee is in support of a visual display that represents communal support of our movement, Black Lives Matter, we and our neighbors feel that at the very least, it should be a collective effort that's community-driven. We want to be a part in designing for the RFP process and creating the message and where it goes. Maybe we don't just want to say Black Lives Matter. Finding artists to participate and make it a community celebration rather than just a party. Our committee is willing to work with the city of Rocky Mountain further, you know, and the neighborhood associations and other anti-racist organizations. And I'm not implying that the city of Rocky Mountain is anti-racist yet. And businesses, the council and manager to develop some ideas of how else we can reappropriate typical budget line items.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Thanks.
The school of government did an article on art improvement in the communities as well. And art is a great place to start with community activity.
I'm going to ask Mr. Sidney Meeks to the podium. I'm sorry. You know, at least once a meeting. I'll absolutely go back and make sure that I include it. I'm sorry. Okay.
Hello. Again, my name is Sydney Meeks, and I will be addressing some of the demands that we've had for our city since our protests that the Rocky Mountain Black Action Committee put on. We demanded acknowledgement and reparations for the genocide and displacement of indigenous people and the enslavement, social, political, economic disenfranchisement of black people. That's number one. Number two, acknowledge and repair black neighborhoods experiencing social immobility and economic drought because of the historic and current disinvestment in black neighborhoods. Number three, provide more minority business development opportunities with less stringent requirements and make it easier for the common person to access information, buying processes, and properly procurement. I also want to address a couple comments of a gentleman saying how a person that's been in a black neighborhood for 17 years, he shouldn't be called out on the mistreatment that he's been serving his customers. When I go to a regular business, a white-owned business, there may be times where I get followed in the store. I shouldn't have to deal with that. I don't care how long you've been in the business. This goes for all the businesses that serve black people. We don't care how long you've been in certain neighborhoods. Once you mistreat us, there will be no justice and no peace until it gets solved. We shouldn't have to settle for the low of the low. We shouldn't have to settle for mistreatment. If a white person, if a white girl that's 24 like me, walks into that same fish market, treat with some respect, I should see, not just based on the color. And so we are tired. I'm tired. I'm 24 years old. I've been in this community almost 13 years now. And I shouldn't, if I want to go to that fish market, I should be able to without the harassment that people have been dealing with. So I just wanted to address that. And also, thank you for addressing the issue of another person calling us dark skin. Please use proper terms when addressing this, and that's for people listening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes,
Ms. O'Reilly, ask you to the podium.
Thank you.
And I'd like to apologize for mixing you up in there, but I'm glad that we got you here.
And save the best for last.
That's right.
And good afternoon, city officials. I am before you to say how proud I am of God's ability to use you to advance the concerns of us citizens. Thank you for the plans to paint Black Lives Matter in our city, and I hope that will include being on the street where I can, you know, private walk on the bus. We were unable to hear the resolution that you read through the audio earlier, so if there's some way that the citizens can have access to what that resolution said, you know, I would appreciate it. Also, I want to urge you to continue vigorously pursuing the hotel for our downtown area. During the last rise of the Tar River, my family had to evacuate the Lake Road area due to rising flood, and we had to go all the way over the river Goodwood to the Winstead Avenue corridor to seek shelter. So it would, you know, that's another positive thing for having a facility on our side of town. And I have an upcoming member union that comes to Rocky Mountain every other year, and we would love to have a facility here locally that can accommodate our family. And thank you, Council, for continuing your vigorous work. I know it's hard. I am praying for all of you, and just continue your work in the grace of God. Thank you.
Thank you. And I will point out the resolution is online on the city's website, so okay. If you're interested in pulling it off, that you can find it there.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, that concludes petitions received from the public. We'll move on to item number 8.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Before we exit, and I've tried restraining myself from all the public as a practice speak all the way. I don't have any issue with that. I would like to, however, clarify at least my perspective in the mind of the public about the role of elected officials, and I do mean all elected officials. State auditor is an elected office. That person serves at the pleasure of her constituents or his constituents, whoever operates that office. And in so doing, along with the members of the local government commission, their role is to serve, to support, and to assist communities in creating fiscal responsibility and accountability, and then working with cities and local governments to build economies. I never envisioned that any city had to go hand in hand begging the local government commission to parry favors because of someone's favorable disposition. The role of the auditor, as I understand it, is to evaluate the fiscal capacity of any governmental entity that they are called to evaluate. That was done. The auditor pointed out within her document and with her staff process recommendations. Well, we not only responded to the auditor's claims, which we took issue with, but we also made corrections in processes, procedures, and even in positions. I find it interesting and enlightening that the auditor continues to talk about Rocky Mount throughout the state when we did just what she asked us to do, which was to respond to process, policies, procedures to deal with whatever issues related to her findings. Even though we took objections with them, information that was presented was incomplete. From my perspective, since my name was called in the agency that I represent, there was lots of hullabaloo about her perspective of redlining, which says that only investment on one side of the line was appropriate, with an $8,000 roof grant that OIC did receive, when the policy clearly states that if you have an address on that street, that property is eligible. There was interesting, there was nothing to note that OIC invested $2.5 million of our own money to leverage the $8,000 that was granted by the city of Rocky Mount. So with that point alone, and with her issues that were called to bear, I choose to say that whatever has been said, process corrections have been made, and you can't evaluate an entire city budget and the management of a budget based on a few points that we even take issue with, frankly, when we have received auditing awards from in-depth audits that were created by or conferred upon us by organizations and entities that deal with all types of municipal finance. So I take the issue, this whole matter, that Rocky Mount is not well managed. If that was the case, we wouldn't have a stellar credit rating where we were able to raise $50 million in a matter of hours. If that's the case, we wouldn't have stellar projects that are being looked at throughout the state of the country, where people are knocking down their doors to move to Rocky Mount as far as industries and businesses and manufacturers are concerned. If that was the case, we wouldn't be enjoying the great growth throughout our entire city that we are enjoying. And when we do submit our application to the local government commission, if for some reason commissioners feel that their evaluation is based as much on the feeling of an individual as it is on the dollars and the leverage and the return on investment in order to pay back a loan, then I call into question what is the evaluation process and what are the merits behind that entity. So I have confidence in the fact that the local government commission is not uncomfortable or unfamiliar with controversy. I have confidence in the fact that each of those individuals have been appointed to do a job to evaluate the deal on the table with the finances that are presented and the projections and the validation of those projections. And I have full confidence that even Ms. Woods and her perspectives can set aside whatever concerns, unless they are meritorious, unless they are directly related to the management and evaluation of that project. My expectations that she, as the elected official, just like I am, are accountable for whatever words that come out of her mouth and written in print, that she's able to prove and support whatever her positions are, just as I plan to be able to do as well.
Thank you, Councilman Blackwell.
Yeah,
acknowledging it tonight, yes, sir.
Yes. And I would like, at some point, for the manager and even the mayor to speak to the inflammatory articles that are being printed about Rocky Mountain leadership, as far as the council, the city manager, and staff. As long as I've been here, we have gotten stellar awards in our audits. Our collection rate, especially utilities, have been as high as 98% in collection. Rocky Mount was one of the cities, along with Kinston, to stand against the heavy burden of the utility crisis that we had when we signed on to the debt. So at some point, I'm proud to serve on this board. I'm proud to be from Rocky Mount. And we have good government and good leadership. The last thing I want to say, if you young man called me a damn preacher, but I'd be damned if I'm not going to be respected, not as a black man, but as a man, period. Because my mama will whoop my tail. And so respect gives respect and earns respect. And everybody on this council, I believe, is asking for respect. I yield to that young man to find his way back to the civil. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Councilman Joyner.
Yes, I would like if we could guideline for the presentation to begin to read those again.
I think that's a good idea.
If we could hold people accountable when they go over that line to pull them back in.
Very well. That brings to item number 8, which is the public hearing. It's an explanation of feasibility study relative to annexation number 316-3786, Weatherford Street, Ward 2. The recommended action is to really hear the explanation of feasibility study by city manager to acknowledge receipt of this.
Thank you. I think as Will Deaton comes forward, I'll be happy to share with you some of the information that has come about as the feasibility of this petition. The subject property is vacant, it's zoned as agricultural residential district. There are no persons currently living on the property. Water is currently available to the subject site. Sewer lines run adjacent to the property. There are no service concerns with the annexation. Based on the information obtained from Edgecombe County Tax Office, the current assessed value, tax value of the petition property is $17,000. The city plans to provide the services that are required under the annexation laws for fire protection, police protection, street maintenance services, water and sewer services, recreation services, as well as environmental services. I think also within the information that's been given to you is a cost analysis, cost of services analysis, which yields to the city a net revenue of $816 annually. So with that, I'll turn it over to Director of Development Services.
Cover all costs associated and convey the property to the city. Parking must remain undeveloped. Ownership will improve access to stormwater infrastructure on city-owned adjacent property. Recommended action is to approve the agreement and authorize the city manager to execute the same on behalf of the city. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Motion made by Councilman Blackwell. Is there a second? Second made by Councilman Joyner. Is there a call for discussion on this matter? Hearing none, I'll ask the city clerk to provide a roll call vote.
Councilmember Knight?
Yes.
Blackwell?
Yes.
Joyner?
Yeah.
Walker? Daughtridge?
Yes.
Bullock? And Miller?
Yes.
Motion carries. Item 11. 11 is consideration of the following agreement with CSX relative to sidewalk construction on Gold Leaf Street across railroad tracks. 1. Construction agreement crossing. 2. Water drainage facility agreement. 3. Grade crossing agreement. Project fees $166,951. Reoccurring annual fee of $45.40, adjusted annually based on CPI. Recommended action is to approve the agreement and authorize the mayor and city clerk to execute the same on behalf of the city. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Motion made by Councilman Blackwell. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Councilman Daughtridge. Is there a call for conversation on this item?
I do have a question, Mr. Chair.
Chair recognizes Councilman Daughtridge.
Yeah, this is for the attorney. Yeah, I forgot. It has to be, if there is a dispute, then we've got to get that before the dispute. We've got to get that into the right. I can give it another argument for the filing.
Is there a call for additional conversation on this matter on the motion on the floor? Hearing none, I'll ask for a voice vote. City clerk.
Councilmember
Knight? Yes.
Blackwell?
Yes.
Joyner?
Yes.
Walker? Daughtridge?
Yes.
Bullock? And Miller?
Yes.
Motion carries. Item 12, are appointments of various advisory boards. Does anybody have names to bring before city council?
There's a for historic preservation commission. Are those categories that we have to fill or just interested individuals, or is it a board appointment? I should end up myself because you gave us books.
So you're asking about item 9?
Yes, I have. Yes.
Can we go to the $1 real quick?
Do you have anybody you'd like to nominate, Councilman Miller? Councilman.
I think the Historic Preservation Commission are board appointees, aren't they? Or are they? They are not, so it's general? Okay.
At large.
And we have how many positions open? Okay. Well, I know that there's a gentleman, Mr. Turner, did he complete an application this weekend? Okay, thank you. Well, I'd like to nominate him unless Mr. Knight nominates.
No, I was going to make a comment.
Okay. Yes, go ahead, Councilman.
That I spoke to
Councilman Blackwell.
Thank you.
City clerk, I do apologize for the commission could get involved. And so what I was going to recommend is going to take a while to go through this book that we prefer at the beginning of the next committee of the whole, if we want to dig deep in it. But if we have names that we know that are ward specific or any names that we want to recommend, we can do so now. But I'd rather, instead of going through the entire book, just to put the board and commission as the first item of the next committee of the whole with other business.
I think that's an excellent idea. But right now, we do have at least one individual that has been nominated by Councilman Blackwell.
Second.
As our second. All in favor, if I could get a voice vote, then.
Yes. Yes.
We'll go through the roll call.
Okay.
Coming back to you. Yes. Yes, ma'am. We will come back to you. All right, so.
That is to appoint Hal Turner to the Historic Preservation Commission. Councilmember Knight?
Yes.
Blackwell?
Yes.
Joyner?
Yes.
Walker? Dodgers?
Yes.
Bullock? And Miller?
Yes.
Motion carries. Councilwoman Miller, did you have somebody specific that you would like to nominate?
Not that specific board.
We are looking for nominations from you for any of the boards that that you would like to nominate for.
Yes.
Joyner?
Yes.
Walker? Dodridge?
Yes.
Bullock? And Miller?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So, okay, motion carries. So the gentleman is now appointed. So we're going to take this, we're going to add it to the committee of the whole. One of the first items, one of the agenda items for the next committee of the whole, so that we go through this in greater detail and really scrub it in our next opportunity. That said, we have two more items on the agenda that we added from the Committee of the Whole earlier. Item number 12 is recognizing Juneteenth as a paid holiday amongst employees for the City of Rocky Mount. There's a motion made by Councilman Joyner, second by Councilman Knight. Is there a need for discussion on this item?
Mr. Mayor.
Chair recognizes Councilman Daltrich.
As mentioned in the Committee of the Whole, I wholeheartedly support a Juneteenth holiday. My concerns around the offset of the expense, and I was assured that that we could be working the budget, which enables me to support it, not just because I want to, but also because of being fiscally responsible.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Is there a need for additional discussion on this matter?
No. That's
Chair recognizes Councilman Knight.
The city manager and committee of the whole did explain that we have the money to do so, and that as far as the question about fiscal responsibility, she did her due diligence, she could speak for herself, and recommended that, and
Okay. Is there a need for additional conversation on the matter? Motion on the floor? Hearing none, I'll ask the clerk if there are a roll vote.
Yes, Member Nye.
Yes.
Blackwell.
Yes.
Joyner.
Yes.
Swanberg. Dodridge.
Yes.
Bullock.
Yes.
And Miller.
Yes.
Okay. Motion carries. Item 13, which is the last stated agenda item, is to approve the memo of understanding between Wota Cooper and the City of Rocky Mount as it relates to the Tarboro Street, what we call that, development or project.
Make a motion to accept the MOU of understanding.
Councilman Knight makes a motion. Is there a second? Second by Councilman Joyner. Is there a need for discussion on this item?
No, this is Councilman Blackwood Ward.
I'll second that. I'll move it.
All right. Additional discussion. Hearing none, I'll ask for a voice vote.
Yes.
Knight.
Yes.
Blackwell.
Yes.
Joyner.
Yes.
Walker. Dot.
Yes.
Dodridge.
Yes.
Bullock. And Miller.
Yes.
Motion carries. With that, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Mr. Mayor, yeah.
Okay, is Chair recognized against the Dodgers?
I just want to make, since we're requesting things to the community as a whole, I'm going to request that the Mayor Pro Tem add, there was an email going back and forth back from May 28th and June 9th regarding the utilities and the what we do on election processes in my office. It was suggested it would be on this month's committee of the whole, but it was not, so I would appreciate if you could put that up in the committee of the whole for August meetings.
I would get that, and I will take a look at it and put it under consideration with the city manager.
Okay, I have a motion to adjourn. Councilman Knight, is there a second? No. Yes, sir. I'll give an apology. Councilman Jordan.
That the Berkshire community has successfully purchased a home that they have entered into a building to do homeownership, and they would start the rehab of their home tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock on the 1816 Duncan Street Drive, and it is a celebrated moment in Ward 3 that a community organization, and thanks to the city and city manager and so many other organizations for leading this community and taking the responsibility to turn their community back into homeownership. We invite you to come over and celebrate and work along with us as we do this as a community.
That's an outstanding development. Thank you for sharing.
And I want to salute you, congratulate you, hope that we can model that. I ask that you could also come to World One and do that. Chase, work along with your vision and the hard efforts of your constituents. Congratulations.
Are there any other items? Anybody? Party comments will come. Being none, I will entertain a motion to dismiss. Made by Councilman Knight, seconded by Councilman Joyner. All in favor, please say aye.